Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, the evidence in this case has been presented, and the attorneys have completed their summations. We now arrive at that time when you, as jurors, are to perform your final function in this case. At the outset, let me express my thanks and appreciation to you for your attention to this case. I'd like to commend to counsel for the professional manner in which they have presented their respective cases and for their courtesy to the court and jury during the course of this trial. Before you retire to deliberate and reach your verdict, it is my obligation to instruct you as to the principles of law applicable to this case. You shall consider my instructions in their entirety and not pick out any particular instruction and overemphasize it. Generally speaking, these instructions consist of four parts. The first part deals with the general principles of law that apply to a criminal case. The second part describes the evidence that you may consider in your deliberations. The third part is about the portions of the criminal code of New Jersey that you must apply to the facts you find in this case to determine whether the state has proven beyond a reasonable doubt that the defendant violated a specific criminal statute. Finally, the fourth part of this instruction tells you how to go about conducting your deliberations. You must accept and apply this law for this case as I give it to you in this charge. Any ideas you have of what the law is or what the law should be, or any statements by the attorneys as to what the law may be, must be disregarded by you if they are in conflict with my charge. Now, beginning with the general principles of law that apply to a criminal case, the defendant stands before you on an indictment returned by the grand jury, charging him with murder, possession of a weapon for an unlawful purpose, a knife, unlawful possession of a weapon, a knife, possession of a weapon for an unlawful purpose, a golf club, possession of a weapon for an unlawful purpose, a lamp, hindering apprehension or prosecution, and tampering with physical evidence. The indictment is not evidence of the defendant's guilt on the charges. An indictment is a step in the procedure to bring the matter before the court and jury for the jury's ultimate determination as to whether the defendant is guilty or not guilty on the charges stated in it. The defendant has pleaded not guilty to the charges. The defendant on trial is presumed to be innocent, and unless each and every essential element of an offense charge is proved beyond a reasonable doubt, the defendant must be found not guilty of that charge. The burden of proving each element of a charge beyond a reasonable doubt rests upon the state, and that burden never shifts to the defendant. The defendant in a criminal case has no obligation or duty to prove his innocence or offer any proof relating to his innocence. The prosecution must prove its case by more than a mere preponderance of the evidence, but not necessarily to an absolute certainty. The state has the burden of proving the defendant guilty beyond a reasonable doubt. Now, some of you may have served as jurors in civil cases where you were told it is necessary to prove only that a fact is more likely true than not true. In criminal cases, the state's proof must be more powerful than that. It must be beyond a reasonable doubt. Now, a reasonable doubt is an honest and reasonable uncertainty in your minds about the guilt of the defendant after you have given full and impartial consideration to all of the evidence. A reasonable doubt may arise from the evidence itself or from a lack of evidence. It is a doubt that a reasonable person hearing the same evidence would have. Proof beyond a reasonable doubt is proof, for example, that leaves you firmly convinced of the defendant's guilt. In this world, we know very few things with absolute certainty. In criminal cases, the law does not require proof that overcomes every possible doubt. If, based on your consideration of the evidence, you are firmly convinced that the defendant is guilty of the crime charged, you must find him guilty. If, on the other hand, you are not firmly convinced of defendant's guilt, you must give the defendant the benefit of the doubt and find him not guilty. The function of the judge is separate and distinct from the function of the jury. It's my responsibility to determine all questions of law arising during the trial and and to instruct the jury as to the law which applies in this case. You must accept the laws given to you by me and apply it to the facts as you find them to be. Now, during the course of the trial, it was required to make certain rulings on the admissibility of the evidence, either in your presence or outside of your presence. These rulings involved questions of law. The comments of the attorneys on these matters were not evidence. In ruling, I've decided questions of law, and whatever the ruling may have been in any particular instance, you should understand it was not an expression or opinion by me on the merits of the case. Neither should my other rulings on any other aspect of the trial be taken as favoring one side or the other. Each matter was decided on its own merits. I may have sustained an objection to some questions asked by counsel, which may have contained statements of fact. The mere fact that an attorney asks a question and inserts facts or comments or opinions in that question in no way proves the existence of those facts. You will only consider such facts which, in your judgment, have been proven by the testimony of witnesses or from exhibits admitted into evidence by the court. I'm not certain I did ask any questions, but if I did ask a question of a witness in the case, this must not influence your deliberations in any way. The fact that I asked a witness a question does not indicate that I hold any opinion one way or the other as to the testimony given by the witness. Any remarks made by me to counsel or by counsel to me or between counsel are not evidence and should not affect or play any part in your deliberations. As I instructed you when we started the case, I explained to you that you are the judges of the facts, and as judges of the facts, you are to determine the credibility of the various witnesses as well as the weight attached to their testimony. You and you alone are the sole exclusive judges of the evidence, of the credibility of the witnesses and weight to be attached to the testimony of each witness. Regardless of what counsel said or I may have said recalling the evidence in this case, it is your recollection of the evidence that should guide you as judges of the facts. Arguments, statements, remarks, openings, and summations of counsel are not evidence and must not be treated as evidence. Although the attorneys may point out what they think important in this case, you must rely solely upon your understanding and recollection of the evidence that was admitted during the trial. Whether or not the defendant has been proven guilty beyond a reasonable doubt is for you to determine based on all the evidence presented during the trial. Any comments by counsel are not controlled. It is your sworn duty to arrive at a just conclusion after considering all the evidence which was presented during the course of the trial. Now I'll move on to the second part of the instructions and discuss the evidence that you may consider in judging the facts of the case. When I use the term evidence, I mean the testimony you have heard and seen from this witness box, any stipulations and exhibits that have been admitted into evidence. Any exhibit that has not been admitted into evidence cannot be given to you in the jury room, even though it may have been marked for identification. Only those items admitted into evidence can be given to you. Any testimony that I may have had the occasion to strike as not evidence shall not enter in your final deliberations. It must be disregarded by you. This means that even though you may remember the testimony, you are not to use it in your discussions or deliberations. Further, if I gave a limiting instruction as to how to use certain evidence, that evidence must be considered by you for that purpose only. Cannot use it for any other purpose. As jurors, it is your duty to weigh the evidence calmly and without passion, prejudice, or sympathy. Any influence caused by these emotions has the potential to deprive both the state and the defendant of what you promised them, a fair and impartial trial by fair and impartial jurors. Also, speculation, conjecture, and other forms of guessing play no role in the performance of your duty. Now, as I instructed you in the beginning of the case, evidence may be either direct or circumstantial. Direct evidence means evidence that directly proves a fact without an inference and which in itself, if true, conclusively establishes that fact. On the other hand, circumstantial evidence means evidence that proves a fact from which an inference of the existence by direct evidence. They may be proven by direct evidence, circumstantial evidence, or by a combination of direct and circumstantial evidence. All are acceptable as a means of proof. In many cases, circumstantial evidence may be more certain, satisfying, and persuasive than direct evidence. And you'll remember the example I gave you in the beginning about snow. Someone comes in and testifies that it snowed before they went to sleep. That's direct evidence that it snowed. But if someone comes in and testifies, well, when I went to sleep, there was no snow on the ground, but when I awoke, there was snow on the ground, that's an example of circumstantial evidence because you could infer that it snowed during the night. Okay. However, direct and circumstantial evidence should be scrutinized and evaluated carefully. A verdict of guilty may be based on direct evidence alone, circumstantial evidence alone, or a combination of direct evidence and circumstantial evidence, provided, of course, that it convinces you of a defendant's guilt beyond a reasonable doubt. The reverse is also true. A defendant may be found not guilty by reason of direct evidence, circumstantial evidence, a combination of the two, or a lack of evidence if it raises in your mind a reasonable doubt as to the defendant's guilt. Now, as judges of the facts, you are to determine the credibility of the witnesses and in determining whether a witness is worthy of belief and therefore credible, you may take into consideration the appearance and demeanor of the witness, the manner in which he or she may have testified, the witness's interest in the outcome of the trial, if any, his or her means of obtaining knowledge of the facts, the witness's power of discernment, meaning his or her judgment or understanding, his or her ability to reason, observe, recollect, and relate, the possible bias, if any, in favor of the side for whom the witness is testifying, the extent to which, if at all, each witness is either corroborated or contradicted, supported or discredited by other evidence, whether the witness testified with an intent to deceive you, the reasonableness or unreasonableness of the testimony the witness has given, whether the witness made any inconsistent or contradictory statement, and any and all other matters in the evidence which serve to support or discredit his or her testimony. Through this analysis, as judges of the facts, you weigh the testimony of each witness and then decide the weight to give to it. Through that process, you may accept all of it, a portion of it, or none of it. As you know, Conrad Sipa elected not to testify at trial. It is his constitutional right to remain silent. You must not consider for any purpose or in any manner in arriving at your verdict the fact that he did not testify. That fact should not enter into your deliberations or discussions in any manner at any time. Conrad Sipa is entitled to have the jury consider all the evidence presented at trial. He is presumed innocent even if he chooses not to testify. As a general rule, witnesses can testify only as to facts known by them. This rule ordinarily does not permit the opinion of a witness to be received as evidence. However, an exception to this rule exists in the case of an expert witness, who may give his or her opinion as to any matter in which he or she is versed, which is material to the case. In legal terminology, an expert witness is a witness who has some special knowledge, skill, experience, or training that is not possessed by the ordinary juror, and who thus may be able to provide assistance to the jury in understanding the evidence presented and determine the facts in this case. Now, in this case, the state presented expert testimony from Dr. Ian Hood, who was an expert in forensic pathology and the medical examiner in this case, John Barkowski, an expert in blood spatter and crime scene reconstruction, Detective Sergeant Valerie Starkey, an expert in fingerprint analysis, Allison Lane, an expert in biological stain identification, and Teresa Nezeza, an expert in forensic DNA analysis. The defense presented Janice M. Johnson, an expert in blood spatter and crime scene reconstruction. You are not bound by these expert opinions, but should consider each opinion and give it the weight to which you deem it is entitled. And that would be whether you give it great weight or slight weight, or you may reject it. In examining each opinion, you may consider the reasons given for it, if any, and you may also consider the qualifications and credibility of the expert. It's always within the special function of the jury to determine whether the facts on which the answer or testimony of an expert is based actually exist. The value or weight of the opinion of the expert is dependent upon and no stronger than the facts on which it is based. In other words, the probative value of the opinion will depend upon whether, from all of the evidence in the case, you find that those facts are true. You may, in fact, determine from the evidence in the case the facts that form the basis of the opinion are true, are not true, or are true in part only, and in light of such findings, you should decide what effect such determination has upon the weight to be given to the opinion of the expert. Your acceptance or rejection of the expert opinion will depend, therefore, to some extent, on your findings as to the truth of the facts relied upon. The ultimate determination of whether or not the state has proven defendant's guilt beyond a reasonable doubt is to be made only by the jury. If you believe that any witness or party willfully or knowingly testified falsely to any material facts in the case with intent to deceive you, you may give such weight to his or her testimony as you may deem it is entitled. You may believe some of it, or you may, in your discretion, disregard all of it. Now I'll instruct you on the third part of the instructions, and these are the portions of the criminal